February 27 meeting of the North Reading School Committee is called to order at 6:32. And the first item on our agenda is public input. Anything that's not on our agenda? Yes, sir.
Scott, get a microphone because the cable won't pick it up.
Thank you. I just have one quick announcement more than anything. I know you guys are really good about supporting the different events that are going on in the community, in the schools. A little school this year, instead of doing just an auction, they're doing a comedy show, a comedy night, and so that's the replacement for the auction. So instead of just inviting people to come just to spend their money, they're at least going to try to entertain people this year. So if people are around March 10th at the Moose Lodge at 7 p.m., there's a comedy night, and that's the main fundraiser this year for the little school. And so I just wanted to cordially invite everybody on the committee and everybody here if they wanted to attend.
Great.
That's all.
Thank you very much.
For you. I'll buy you.
It's funny. I've always thought that these were the comedy nights for the school department, but little do I know.
Anything else? No, I don't see any other. Student report is next item on our agenda. North Reading High School student Michael Tyrell, class of 2019, is with us tonight.
Good evening. I'm Michael Tyrell, a member of the class of 2019. If I misspeak, help me out here. This is my first day back from vacation, so I'm a little sluggish. On the other hand, our amazing athletes on our winter sports teams have been anything but sluggish. Many of our winter sports teams have found major success through this season. We will be celebrating this success, as well as the coaches and students that produce it, at the Winter Sports Awards, which will take place on March 7th at 6:30 in the high school gym. The boys basketball team is playing Greater Lawrence here at 7 o'clock on Wednesday. This is the first round of the postseason, and the student body will be cheering this team through as they progress through the playoffs. The girls basketball team is also in the playoffs, and having progressed to the quarterfinals, they'll be playing at Amesbury. The success is not limited to basketball, and our ice hockey team, who have a bye this week, will be playing the winner of a game between Lincoln Sudbury and Pawtucket. This game between North Reading and the winner of that game will take place on Friday, March 3rd, at a location that is still to be decided. Track and field had their divisional competition on Friday, February 17th. The boys placed fourth, while the girls were third. Five boys and three girls qualified for all states, a terrific achievement, given that only the top three for each event in each division qualify for all states. For the boys, Tom Helms qualified in the 600 meters, George Jinta, Jensen Katamadam, William Lord, and Justin Capizzuto in the 4x2. For girls, Emily Russ qualified in the high jump, and Juliet Nadeau did so in the long jump. Meredith Griffin qualified in the mile. Lastly, the cheerleaders won the Cape Ann League last Wednesday, a terrific achievement. As winter sports begin to wind down, and before spring sports begin the week of March 20th, there are numerous other events taking place at the school and the district. On Friday, March 3rd, Chris Heron will be speaking to students in grade 7 to grade 12, delivering an anti-drug message. I extend my thanks and the thanks of the student body to the terrific work of the Parent Teachers Association in allowing such an amazing event to take place. Their work has enabled us to have brilliant speakers here, and this is the latest example of this amazing work. On March 15th, high school parent-teacher conferences will be taking place from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. College letters will also begin to arrive in mid-March, with the last arriving in May. I'm hopeful that all our students get into great schools, which I'm sure they will. Around this time, on March 28th, the 14th annual college fair will also be hosted. A number of clubs in the school are hosting events during this time as well, including the dance team and student council. The dance team, which has been a club for nearly 3 years, has had major success this year in events such as Dancing with the Hornets, which I'm sure you all remember. Their latest event is the Dance-a-thon, a novel and original idea that'll most likely run later this spring. Here, teams will compete in a long 4-hour dancing competition, with the remaining teams taking home a prize. The Dance-a-thon is not the only pioneering idea this spring. The student council will be hosting Raid the Room, a program that brings an escape room to an event. An escape room is an activity in which groups of people must work together to solve logic puzzles and physical challenges to escape a room. If you know of Bodaborg, this is an example of an escape room. This one is different because they'll bring the escape room to us. This event is only meant for student council members so far, and it is a pilot. However, if it is successful, this event could be instituted as a Spirit Week event in the school or other event throughout the year. Lastly, the junior class will be hosting a volleyball tournament fundraiser on March 16th, directly after school. As you can see, although the two sports seasons, we're in the middle of the two currently, there are still many events that are going on throughout the school. I have one piece of work here. This is from my US History 2 class, and we were tasked with creating an interview, coming up with questions and then answering those questions from the perspective of Teddy Roosevelt. This helps us to get an understanding of his bombastic personality and just the way that he dealt with issues during the time, as well as help us further our understanding of what was going on during the progressive movement and the early 1900s. So the rubric is on the back, and I will pass that around. Thank you.
Have any?
When was the? You mentioned Chris Herron. When yes. was that, and where?
So Chris Herron will be speaking here on Friday, March 3rd at the high school.
Oh, March 3rd. What time is that?
That is, it's throughout the day, isn't it?
It's during the day.
9 o'clock, yes.
Oh, really?
Right. It's a student presentation.
Okay.
He might be one of the most effective speakers I've ever seen in terms of anti-substance abuse and those areas, because obviously he was a tremendous, tremendous basketball talent.
He played at Boston College and for the Celtics.
Yeah, and he destroyed his career with drugs.
And he's really good. Right. Really good.
I'm not sure if you're aware. We did have him here years ago. But it's a new crop of students coming.
He's so good.
Now, so it'll be their first time. So
very effective.
He is.
So
good.
Will you do like a middle school presentation and a high school presentation?
Right. Okay. Yeah, and the high school, I believe they're both in the gym. I know the high school presentation is in the gymnasium.
Cliff, I wanted to mention one other thing. Sure. It's not a North Reading team per se, but we do have, I believe, about a half dozen girls playing on the Peabody Linfield North Reading hockey team.
They make the tournament?
They qualify for the state. It's the first time this year. Yeah. And they're the lowest seed. They qualified at 19th, but they're playing the 11th seed. I think they're playing Woburn in a playing game.
Right.
So, and I know that, I don't know the date, but I know the cheerleaders will also be participating in a state
competition.
Yeah. Oh, and one other thing, I don't know if you mentioned, Saturday is the Drama Fest here. I think we have 8 schools, and they've been here, they'll be here all week. They're here at night learning about our stage and all our technical systems, equipment, and where they should put their sets and all that kind of stuff.
It's one of those great benefits of having the Performing Arts Center here.
I was going to say that. I know this school costs a lot of money, and we're all paying for it every day. But we could never, ever do the stuff we're doing at this school without this facility.
Right.
Never. Everything benefit from athletics to the arts to academics. We just couldn't do it. So.
In that order.
Yes, athletics always first. Yeah. But Saturday should be exciting here because the North Reading Maskers perform first at 9 o'clock, and then after that there's 7 other schools to follow. It's great to show off the school
absolutely
to the other schools.
Last year they made it to the next round, right?
They made it to the finals last year.
To the finals.
It's not just a matter that we can do it now with this facility. It's that it broadens the horizons of all of our students because we can do it.
Well, and I also know, just speaking with Mr. Conley, that we're getting a lot more interest in the Performing Arts Center.
We are.
Now here.
Yes.
And I know that one of our presentations coming up from Chartwell's, I think we're seeing a lot of positives in that program because of our new facilities also. And I know Anna will address that. So, again, we thank the community a lot, but we have a lot to be thankful for having this facility. And if you haven't seen it, if you've never seen it, come up here, have Mr. Bernard give you a tour. No,
absolutely. I love showing you.
It's just a great facility.
Thank you.
Good. Thank you very much.
Good job.
Thank you.
Michael, I'll get your work to you, okay? Thank you.
You weren't sluggish at all.
No.
Glad. I'm trying to wake up still.
All right, next item on our agenda is MSBA, SSBC update.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just I have a bit of a brief update for you this evening. I thought it was important to inform the committee that tomorrow, actually, I have a conference call with representatives of Gilbane and the Austro Electrical Company. to talk about our continued work to address some outstanding issues with the AV systems of the middle high school, and also to assess those systems so that we can have some final training sessions coming up. Right now they're scheduled for the week of March the 21st. But I expect more information coming out of that conference call tomorrow. I did also, along that same line, I thought it was important to let the committee know that Aukers, who was the company that had been responsible for the installation of a lot of the systems, had reached out to Dr. Daly back a few weeks ago with their interest in helping us to resolve any items that we were either unclear on how they were operating or if we were in any way dissatisfied with anything. And so we took a meeting with them, Dr. Daly and I did, and we had I would consider it to be a pretty productive meeting back in early February. And that resulted in them coming out to the building last Tuesday with a team of, it varied from anywhere from about 4 to 6 people at any given time based on some folks coming in, others leaving and such. But they did a pretty thorough assessment for us on some identified issues that we had provided to them in the form of a Google Doc. And they produced a report for us on some things that they felt that they could work to resolve. So I'm going to be introducing that as part of the discussion tomorrow, with the hope of us, resolving any outstanding items and also learning more about the very sophisticated systems that this building has. With respect to the punch list, I don't have a lot to report to you. There was, I had hopes that and had been informed that a good deal of work would take place over the February school vacation, but that did not happen, much to my disappointment, quite honestly. So we do have a building committee meeting tomorrow night. I expect that PMA and I and or I will be working to get a schedule that has been requested many times from Gilbane as to when they expect to resolve these outstanding items. So a slight bit of disappointment, quite honestly, that I don't have more to report. I had asked for a report from the Gilbane representative to provide to me, and I had been told I would have it early this week, but I have not received anything as far as I can report to you right now. So that's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chair, I just want to make a statement. You'd think that companies trying to close a project in negotiations with us might be living up to their promises in terms of getting here and doing things they're supposed to be doing.
One would think.
That's the only statement I have to make.
Just a couple questions.
Yes.
I've talked to some parents, specifically middle school theater parents, and one woman asked about a leaking room over the stage. Is there a major leak happening there?
There has been a leak on the stage.
Okay.
That's been going on for quite a while, but
okay.
I do not know of it leaking anytime recently. We did.
I think it was during, rehearsals,
like in say the fall.
Oh, just recently for Alice.
The fall would have been the last time that it might have been very early on in the performances.
Okay.
But we had the roofers out here to resolve a couple
okay.
of leaks. One was in the central office in kind of a skylight unit.
Okay.
And there was one over the stage, and there was one in the elevator shaft actually, where water had been coming in through a vent.
Okay.
But I have no reports. It's probably been 2 months maybe since that happened, but I haven't learned of any additional issues with that.
And
you're saying that they did come in and fix the leak on the stage?
Yeah,
is that was a problem a while ago.
Oh, it was. It was probably going back to maybe even 2 years ago when the high school first opened. And it had been an ongoing problem, but we had Silktown roofers out, I'm going to say in like December, to do some work, and I have not heard any reports of, and usually I get an email from the teachers. It's kind of a group email that goes to Wayne Hardick or me, the principals, but I have not heard of anything. I haven't heard of anything. Probably, I'm going to say
it's
like 6 to 8 weeks.
Just be sure. Maybe
yeah,
Ms.
sure.
Lister.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think
it was reported to a parent from, staff members.
I can tell you that issues get reported, but sure,
okay.
I don't mind checking. I don't know of anything recent.
Okay, and then
it was around a hatch. There's a hatch in the roof in that area, and my understanding is it was coming at the seam of the hatch where the hatch meets the roof.
And then just another question about the sound system. Apparently, the Middle School Parents Association has to rent microphones.
Yes.
For productions, and there's been issues with sound and compatibility. Is that something that we can assist our theater groups with, or?
Sure, I'm not. I do know that they rent them. I'm not aware of an issue with the compatibility of them, but sure, you can direct folks to me.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd be happy to.
Well, it's not just the middle school, it's the high school as well, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know.
Those microphones, we had actually looked into them at one point in time, and I think they were about $1,000 a piece, my right?
They're really expensive.
They're a lavalier model, right? We got a certain number with the project.
Yeah, so what came with the project?
There was a certain number of them that came. I don't remember the number quite honestly. Okay. It was a small. It was like four, maybe six.
It was very
six.
Small.
Yeah, it was not a large number.
Go to those productions. Every kid out there
right.
has
right.
a mic.
Especially on the musicals.
Yeah. No, but I'm just wondering is, you know, what we have available, will they not work with the additional ones that they have to rent?
Well, from what I've seen, I've been to every production. They seem to be working. Now, I'm not sure if they're talking
Yeah, I'm not aware of a compatibility specific. Issue.
Okay.
If there's an, I mean... I will agree that sometimes if you're sitting in the back, and then again, it's me, so
no,
it's not 100%, but...
Well, I know Saturday, it was not good.
When I went Friday night, there were some actors that you could not hear at all
right.
for, like, the first half of the
right.
show.
Are you talking about...
The middle school show.
Really?
Yeah.
On Friday night?
Yeah, there were at least a couple that you couldn't...
Saturday was not.
I was there on Friday. I thought it was okay.
Okay.
They said Friday was better, but was okay. Saturday...
Usually, I'm the first one not to be able to hear something, so I heard everything on that Friday.
Yeah, Cliff
night.
And I were sitting in the very back.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, I was there Friday. I didn't.
I guess I didn't realize that the theater groups had to rent them. I thought
yes.
that they
yes.
would have been.
I think
they would have had enough.
Unfortunately, they've come to us, and there's no room in the budget for it. Like with a lot of the athletic things that get paid for through the athletic, there's gonna. Or the athletic boosters.
There was a time going back.
They were trying to raise money.
Or they were going to take the money that they were using to appropriate for the rentals.
Right. They were
going to start to purchase them.
We've had this discussion.
That's probably two. I haven't heard any more from it.
Okay.
It's probably
the first time I've heard it, so I just thought I would bring it forward.
If there's a compatibility problem with the ones that you rent, you ought to rent different ones.
No, I'm just saying with the current system that we have, if we have four. And, but they're not compatible with the additional ones they have to buy. You know, that's...
Well, they've been renting them since day one, so we're going back over 2 years.
Yeah. Right, 3 years they rented them, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
High school,
all the way
too.
Back to Peter Pan, I think.
And Marcy's come in here and asked us for money to
yeah.
buy some, and we've
yeah.
said we don't have the money.
Yeah, I've heard nothing since that time, and it's probably close to 2 years ago. I'm not aware of any issues with the compatibility, and as far as I know, the rentals continue. To have the number that they're seeking to have.
All right.
The only other thing I wanted to add, Cliff, is that we add this SSBC is meeting tomorrow.
Right.
It's going to be, we'll hear that at the end of the agenda. So we'll address some of these issues, obviously, at the SSBC meeting, as you're
we'll
well
bring
aware.
Them up.
Yeah.
We won't necessarily get resolution.
Is there
right?
a pre-meeting, John, tomorrow?
There is not.
There's no pre-meeting.
Okay. I should add, you know, I do continue to receive very good support from PMA representatives that are on this project. They had written a very extensive email midweek, late last week, to Gilbane requesting a status. So it's not for a lack of initiative to try to get the items resolved or people not working with the school department to try to make that happen, at least from our project manager's standpoint.
And again, the caveat that we give every time we give one of these
yes.
reports is
right.
that we are holding money. The money has
right.
not been paid. It will be held until the work is completed. We are getting very close to negotiating a final price so that, you know,
correct.
Hopefully we can wrap up, you know, I would hope after some time before the end of the fiscal year or thereabouts.
That would be good.
Yeah. That would be
yes.
excellent.
Don't want to get in the way of the negotiation on that. Next item on our agenda is a presentation by Chartwells, Anna McGovern, and Christopher Callahan. We have a presentation for us.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Thank you, Anna. I heard that.
Yeah.
But before you get started, you know, 2 years ago
okay.
or 3 years
okay,
ago, you guys came in here with all kinds of goodies
okay.
and parfaits and
I remember that.
Whatnot. Uh-oh. I know why, because you can't bring food in here, right? I know. No food or drink.
That's
it's
right.
the superintendent's fault.
Yeah.
I wanted to make sure it was
yeah.
whose fault it was. Okay.
I get told all the time, it's not a museum, it's a school. I said, it's still a museum. It's still a bit of a museum.
I did mention that, so.
Maybe when the school's 5 years old.
Right.
That's probably about right.
Maybe. Okay.
It'll be broken in.
Well, thank you for having me, us again. I can't believe the year went that quickly already. Seems like we were just here last year, and it's the year. It's almost March. We have some great progress this year. I'll go over the first couple of slides, and then we'll turn it over to Anna from there. But financially, we're off to a great start. Just looking at the first slide here.
I'm trying to get that mic working, so.
So this one will not work if you tap it.
Yeah, give it a second to come on, I think.
There you go. Okay. All right. So looking at the year, again, just slightly down in enrollment, but our meal counts are up by 3,000 meals. And our cash sales are up as well. Again, with enrollment down, we're up close to $9,000 in cash sales and reimbursements. Anna and her team's done a great job managing costs. Her product costs are down. Her other direct costs are down. Her labor costs are somewhat flat, just slightly higher than the last year, but given merit increases and whatnot and step increases for the staff, she's held that in check as well. But overall, looking at our sales are being up and our expenses are down. Our program subsidy is only at $7,500 versus $24,000 last year. So it's a huge improvement year over year. And we've got a good portion of the year left, which is a great sign. February is a little challenging. We did have 2 snow days, so only 12 service days in February. So we want to see how February turns out. But this is the time of year where we start to gain some profits. So we should bite into that subsidy a little bit more as well. The second slide we have here just gives you a little, again, data analysis. Our meal counts, daily sales are up by 3%, despite a 1.5% drop in enrollment. Another interesting factor is there's a 7% drop in free and reduced eligibility participation. So that means that our free and reduced population is down. And so that's nice to see that our revenue is up. So the people who are actually, they're actually buying the meals. So it's a good sign. Program costs are down by 3%. Again, our subsidies have been reduced by 2/3 through January. The next few bullet points are some of the things we've been talking about for the last year and a half with Mike and John and the committee. So we've did some upgrades at the high school level. We added some tall cafe tables, which we have a picture in the presentation a little bit later. It's an area where it's a little more comfortable for the students to sit. Do their work. That we've got a large screen, flat screen TV. We've got some music pumped into the area. We also added data chargers for the students so that they can charge their cell phones and their computers. So it's a nice little area for the students to gather. I think a couple years ago we were a little, you know, they were all kind of migrating to the library, which is really nice. So we thought we'd upgrade this area, and I think the feedback's been really good for the tall tables. And the next slide, you'll see just a graph showing, you know, our progress. You know, when the federal regulations came out 3 years back, really took us, hit us hard on the bottom line. But we've been battling back over the last 5 years, and we're almost at break even. So we're actually ahead of our budgeted plan this year. We expect to stay that. I think we've achieved our budget for the last 3 years. So we just keep you know, biting away at that subsidy for the community.
This is a slide I'd like to, when we're meeting at the finance planning team, for example, this is a slide we should show them and how, you know, Michael, you, Troutwells, Carl before Michael started the work, mm-hmm. that we've worked at basically a $120,000 deficit down to almost break even mm-hmm. working with Troutwells. And I think it speaks well of mm-hmm. both Troutwells but and the school department and the school committee working together to make this happen.
It's been a great partnership, and Mr. Webster, I have to agree with you and your comment a little while ago that the facility makes a ton of difference. You know, the efficiency of scale, having the middle school and high school in one building, that has actually helped out a lot as well. and we have the facility and resources to really showcase some great products and services.
No, absolutely.
With that, I'll turn it over to Anna to finish a few other slides. So.
Thank you again, everybody.
This will work, Anna, too.
Okay. That's for the room. Thank you again. It is a great partnership. I've been here for 13 years. I thoroughly enjoy it, and we've seen the lows on that financial schedule, how difficult that was, and we're just coming back from it. The facility, as Mel had said, and everybody, I walk into this facility every morning, and I think, oh, my goodness, how lucky we are to have this facility, the kitchen. It's much more efficient as far as inventory. Everything is here. You need one from here. It just goes. I'm not having shipments to every other school. It just really, really helps having this beautiful facility and having much more control over it. So we still do the refreshments for the AC meetings on a biweekly basis. The breakfast for guidance, they're always coming to me for something. Dr. Daly came for me this afternoon and asked me if he could have lunch at 1 o'clock for 15 people. Right? So we said, yes, we, I said, yes, we can. I will take care of it for you. So we were going to do the academic decathlon because of the snow, although I have to thank John Bernard for only having 2 snow days in February. Many schools had 3 or 4, so I was very glad that there was a delay on Friday. And we all talked about the Drama Fest. There's, right now the count is 161. It's prepaid, and Charles, we're doing the food for that for them for this year. This is the second year in a row that she's come to us, and it works out well. We figured out all the little tweaks, and so we're happy about that. We're happy to do that for them.
The nice thing about, again, the additional catering and the revenue, it all accrues to North Reading's account, so it really helps the overall program. You know, that just that little bit, whether it's a la carte sales or a little catering, that just helps your program. So that's great that we had that ability to take on the requests for that.
And the students are doing well with a la carte. So we did do the breakfast bistro at the high school. New vending machines down at the gym. They're doing so-so. I think that the students know they're there. Some buy it, some don't, but it's okay. Tasty Tuesday promotions at all levels. We'll go, I'll say to, you know, elementary school, if we have something different, like a, whatever it is, a 3-bean salad or a chickpea salad or even something that a small portion, like chicken fajita, I say put, you know, go out there to the schools, to the students in the cafeteria and sampling. Chef to school events, I did have one scheduled for one of the days off, so I have to reschedule that, but we did have one in January at the Little Elementary, and it went over very well. We do offer weekly Lucky Tray Day. I just let the staff at the schools pick your day. You know the day that your students eat. You know the day that you need to boost participation, and they do that very well.
What is Lucky Tray Day?
Lucky Tray Day is a student finds a sticker. I buy stars, you know, little school stars. I put them at the bottom of the tray. It's at random. And I probably offer, you know, 6, maybe 2 a lunch, 2 or 3 a lunch, because the children are so excited when they get that bag snack or an ice cream. And in the elementary schools, when the kindergarten and first graders cannot buy snacks during the week, we hold their name and they come up on the Friday and they get it. So we've figured it all out so that everyone is happy. We do the free yogurt and granola parfait. Sometimes I go up and down Main Street or I offer them granola bars. The week of exams, I was up and down Main Street saying, please eat something before you go in for your class. So it's all about trying to get the right thing to them, the right foods to them. And we do have the enhanced website with new food service links. We have the menus online, and it also give you nutritional information. And this week, it happens to be my week to have an article in the transcript around the schoolyard, which so that'll be in there. So we're looking forward to seeing that. And the high school and middle school daily lunches, they continue to increase. And when they first came up here, I kept hearing that the eighth graders don't eat, they don't eat. Well, I'm telling you, when they come in as freshmen, they eat. And this year, we're not having any issues. The middle school is eating. I think the display of the food, how we offer it, what we do, if they don't need something, if they're looking for something, I'm like, yeah, let me go check on the other side. let me get that for you. You know, wait here, I'll take care of this. So it's the facility makes it so much nicer. Elementary also continue to increase. And we've increased the overall program participation by 3% over last year. You know, people may not think that's, but it's nice. So this is the, in the morning when they come in, we have the big screen TV there, and to the right of the high tables, and that's, a lot of times they congregate there. And now that we have the charges, right here on the side wall.
Bottom left.
And yeah. That's where a lot of the students at lunch, you see them all trying to go there and sit there. And I see a lot of phones there, but that's what it's for, it's technology. So we have to offer that to our students.
Plus you see the seating, it's actually, it's very comfortable seating, rather than having the benches around the tables. You know, the benches serve a purpose for mealtime, but if you're sitting there and studying, you need to have something that's a little bit more comfortable. So that's nice.
Are those used during lunch also, the high tables?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. They're always
popular. Oh, they're
so, I mean, they're the most
popular. They're very popular.
Oh, they are the most popular. The first day we had them, there was a note.
Yeah, they were reserved.
Reserved for senior girls. I'm like, oh, I think we can do that.
We can. And there's a possibility to maybe extend it to the whole wall. There's more room for maybe two or three more tables down the road. I know that we're actually putting those tables also out in Main Street, too, actually have the, so that works out really well, too. So.
And in the morning, the inauguration, I had the news on, you know, things like that, because that's all current events. I do have the news, and good, bad, or indifferent, it is current events, and these students need to be aware of what's going on. So that's the high school breakfast, and this was the chef to school at the little elementary. It's all about mindful snacking. That's what my, that was my presentation, fruits and grains. That's also my article for this week's in the transcript.
Anna, can you just talk a little bit more about that? Like what specifically happens? Is it you going to the schools and meeting with kids? How does that work?
It's myself and the operations manager here, Mary Polito. We go to the schools, we set everything up, and I talk to the principals first and let them know what I'm doing. I talk to the nurses first. I give the nurse all the food, anything packaged so that she can read it, and if she doesn't feel that I should use it, I don't.
Okay.
I had no problem today on that one. And I talked to the students, it was about snacking, and I explained to them that snacking is a way of life, it's not ever going away.
It depends on the event, too.
Right.
We also have regional dietitians. Right. And extra regional chefs, too, that come in occasionally.
Mm-hmm.
Depends on the menu and what we're doing.
Okay.
Right. In October, I did Fruits of the Fall. You know, that was one of my main focal points, fruits and vegetables, you know, root vegetables, butternut squash, all of that. And I also tell them, you know, butternut squash, this is what we're having today on the menu, or it's going to be on the menu on Thursday. Try it on Tuesday. So I try to do that. One year we did it at the old middle school, and every student came up. Every student, as they do here too, all the students, they come up. So it was very well received. Chris Smalley was very gracious and let us have that there. So we're hoping to continue with all of these positive things for the town of North Reading. And on another note, I have to say that we have a very good staff, food service. We should all be very proud of the associates that work for the town of North Reading. Many of them are very dedicated. So I don't want that to go unnoticed also. And I think that's it. Any questions?
Thank you very much.
How is the breakfast program doing? And is it partly because of demographics that we're never gonna have a big breakfast demand in a district like North Reading?
It is. We find that our a la carte is growing. They grab maybe a beverage or a coffee or a juice or a muffin, but it seems as though that whether they're eating at home or they're it's probably demographics for the most part.
And do we get any federal reimbursement for breakfast or no?
Yes, but they're not buying the breakfast.
So they bought the whole breakfast.
Right. Yeah, right. And
the
they don't.
Right.
Yeah. And right now I'm just happy that they're coming in and purchasing and talking. They have kids that just come in and sit at the tables with their Dunkin' Donuts and their Starbucks and they just hang out and they talk.
And I think it's fine just offering the coffee and the tea and juice and muffin or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what kids.
And we do breakfast
really
sandwiches,
want.
You know, in compliance, we do a breakfast sandwich. And the prices are very reasonable. We had a teacher come by this morning and said, I've never bought coffee here before. I said, well, this will make your day. So, and it comes right off their accounts.
We met with the students, too. Mm-hmm. We met with the students to find out what they wanted, you know, to before we rolled it out. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's time that we actually sit down again with the student advisory to see anything else they'd like to see.
Student council was good. They in the beginning of the year, they promote the breakfast, and they were giving out pencils. And so I have a lot of involvement from that, too. And the students who do purchase every day, you know, they're great. They go out and tell everybody. I said, tell your friends. I have a punch card. Every time you get, the 10th one is free. So it works out good. The middle school, I brought a cart out there for the month of September and October, and right into the cafeteria because they wait there for their classes. And nothing. So I just think it might be age, too. Because if one comes up, they might all come up. So I think it's age. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, I've worked with Anna the entire time she's worked in North Reading. And she mentioned about the staff at all of the schools. And they do a very good job. Wonderful ladies that really, I think, care about the children and do a nice job. But Anna is also a very good leader of the food services department. She does a wonderful job. It's interesting that Michael and I have our coffee on Main Street most every morning, maybe 4 out of 5 mornings a week. And Anna knows students' names, very personable. She's very receptive to ideas that Michael or I might bring to her. And Chris, you too, you know, very hands-on. You're here a lot. And I think the work that you're doing with Michael, who spends an inordinate amount of time working with food services as well, we're seeing the results of the hard work in the offset to the subsidy. And I think it's a good goal that we've set. And I know your goal is to get it down to zero, Michael especially. But I think we're headed in a very good direction. I just want to publicly acknowledge the effort that the three of you put forth, as well as the entire department. So thank you.
It's a great working partnership.
Right.
Yeah. I agree.
I have to say that. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I would just to echo those comments. I mean, I think I remember when I started back at the, you know, the first year on that bar graph that you saw earlier, where it was at the peak of the challenges that we were facing, and we were kind of at a crossroads. And I think it would, you know, some of us that were on that committee that were kind of evaluating our options, I think can look 3 or 4 years down later and see at the progress. And I don't think we you know, were confident at that time that we would be where we're at, and that so close to a break-even self-operating program. And I think that goes to the work that certainly the leadership that Anna and Chris provide, and then I think the food service associates and the relationships and the good work that they do. And that I had the opportunity at times to stand in the lunch lines last year, hoping to do it some more this year with Anna, and just kind of observe the operation. And they have a very good relationship with the students.
Yes.
And that rubs off. That's evident. You know, they know the students' names. The line moves very, very quickly with that point of sale line. The kids don't have to, you know, they just pull up the student's name as they see them moving through the line, and they don't have to, you know, remember their pin or punch in their pin. And it moves very, very quickly, and they do a very, very good job.
So. I must say the elementary are much better at remembering their pin.
Yeah.
Elementary and middle. I don't know what happened when they came over to that.
Yeah, sure.
You know, but we do know their names. Yeah. So,
Cliff, two quick questions. One, in terms of the 7% drop in free and reduced lunch eligibility, is that determined by the federal government, or is that the state that determines?
Yeah,
that?
So what we're looking at there is just that is the amount of students that were eligible for free and reduced lunch in terms of either our paper applications, so families that have filled out a paper application and met the qualifications, which is driven by the USDA and what that income eligibility chart, which changes slightly every year based on the poverty levels, et cetera, as well as the new process through the state's direct certification through this virtual gateway program, which is the majority of the students in North Reading that are eligible. I want to say we're like 87-88% of those that are deemed eligible are through the direct certification process through the virtual gateway program. There's a small percent, 10-12%, that are deemed eligible through the paper application process. So given the drop, a little bit of the drop in enrollment, that 7% drop is the number of students as of a snapshot in time. I think we took it as of October 1 that were eligible for free and reduced lunch. So I think we went from 268 students to 249, it's about a 7% drop.
The other question is, do we have a, when kids go through the line, do they have cards that are inserted into a machine, or how do they
pay? No, they come through, and if I know you, it's, so hi, Mel.
So that's
your name
it?
In. And if they remember their PIN,
right.
They put their PIN number in and their name comes up. Nowhere on the screen does it show anything, whether it's a hashtag or a dollar sign or a percentage. In the old system, it was a percentage was reduced or a hashtag was free and a dollar sign was paid. There's none of that.
And so the parents can pay with the credit card through our...
Yeah, so the lunch...
My School Bucks.
My School Bucks system. Mm-hmm. And we did send some through the Blackboard Connect system. I think we're trying to do a better job of promoting the My School Bucks account and making it a little bit easier for families to establish an account. So we made some changes to that at the beginning of
the year. There were quite a few.
And send that out to try to promote parents to utilize the, you know, the prepayment
system.
But you
can still write checks.
So, all that is still
available. Absolutely, you can write checks. I tell the parents, you know, like I have students come in and they'll give me $50 and I'll say, this on your account, can I have 10 back? And I'm like, fine, you know. So then a parent says to me, well, I gave them 50, well, 40 went on the account. I always say, write out a check. That way it will all go on your account.
Yeah.
you have a son at the middle school, correct?
A lot of checks,
correct? I know you do. I know you do.
Thanks.
Well, thank you very much.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Sure. You know, just like Anna was saying, it was, you know, roughly a year ago, I think I presented to you guys last March, you know, kind of an up, you know, it was kind of a description of our model, how it's changing, you know, how we, you know, kind of got started in the past year. Can you hear me okay? So what I wanted to kind of provide was kind of an update of that model, provide some of the larger initiatives we're involved in, and give a, you know, a large update. We've, you know, just to kind of start off, I think everyone in the department's grown tremendously through some of the partnerships and you know, collaboration that we've started and initiated in the district. You know, everyone, you know, I think we're kind of moving in a very strong direction. So let's just give an overview. So on this very first slide, I just want to list some of the digital learning events that we've been a part of in the past year. We had a, back in December, we had a middle high school STEAM Summit Hour of Code, in which we had the robotics company Symbiotic from Wilmington. We had IntelliTech from Derry, New Hampshire, who does robotic software. And we had a number of speakers who came and shared their experiences with developing robotics, and students were able to meet the engineers and also speak to engineers about their careers, and we connected that with the Hour of Code activities. Great event. We able to have the robots come down into the Performing Arts Center. It was really a kind of a great event. Kids kind of, you know, from different, all the way through middle school and high school, were able to kind of experience that day with their teachers. We also were the host of the Go Open Regional Summit at Amazon in Cambridge. Myself and some members of the digital learning team, John Bernard and Patrick Daly. That came about as a partnership of being one of the first three districts in Massachusetts who was a Go Open district. And I could talk a little bit about that in some of our another slide forward, but it was a great opportunity to kind of showcase our connection to this initiative and start to share and learn from other districts who've started taking part of that. Tomorrow, actually, we're going to have a K through 12 STEM learning tour at the Hood Batchelder and also the middle school and high school, where we're going to host 12 other teachers from other districts who are coming to kind of share and collaborate ideas around what we're doing and also talk of kind of some digital learning strategy. You know, it's a very hot topic, especially around robotics and how we're implementing robotics and discussions also around general digital learning topics. We also had the DESE Maple convening, which was held at the Heinz Convention Center. The highlight of this event was really that we had a middle school student tech team who works with our robotics club actually did an amazing Ignite session, where they actually talked about their experiences with their robotics club, and they were to share their experiences with about 28 other school districts. And it was really a great growth moment to see these two middle school students go up there and do an Ignite session and talk powerfully 2 minutes about, you know, what they're learning and sharing with other students. It was really very powerful. We also had as a Future Ready member district, we participated in the Future Ready District event, which allowed our district leadership, as well as some members of our digital learning team, to start kind of envisioning what is a Future Ready district, and begin to take that vision and collaborate with some other districts around that vision. And another highlight of the year was back in October, we had student presentations at the MassQ Fall and Spring, Krista McAuliffe, and also the Maple Conference. The MassQ Conference, you see Michael Tyrell's on that center photo. He was able to show his app, and in the top photo in the center, that's the group of Change Team students who are the high school tech team who worked on their robotics projects, a Raspberry Pi project, and also the mobile app project. So they were able to share that project with other student tech teams. So it's been a tremendous growth year in that we're going out there, we're talking with other districts, we're collaborating, and we're really trying to share everything that we're growing with and gaining new ideas about how that can shift and grow our own program. That's really, you know, I kind of see that as a huge value, is that we're going out and we're taking a leadership role in some of these larger district statewide initiatives that I think help us kind of pave the way for how we want to think about digital learning as we move forward. You know, last year was more of a discussion about here's our model, here's what we're doing, here are some of the things that we're kind of integrating, and now I kind of see moving forward, where how do we grow? How do we continue to keep visioning according to some of the larger Department of Ed initiatives, and also how do we develop leadership that understands what's the next step related to digital learning, and also preparing our staff to kind of take on some of the, you know, the next steps, which include, you know, one-to-one learning and also increased STEM pathways. So a couple listed here that we've been involved with. We're a Future Ready District, helps district leaders plan and implement personalized research-based and learning strategies. We had our STEAM Summit, which was a great way for us to connect with outside businesses and create connections so that we can kind of bring those experiences to students. We were the Go Open District. And as I met with, the last time I met with you, I shared the desire to do the Mass Track surveys. The Mass Track surveys are aligned with the Future Ready Initiative, and they enable us to be able to review the background of our students, our teachers, and kind of getting a very strong understanding of what our next steps are with digital learning in the district. And one thing I'd like to share off here is the Maple Catalyst. We are a Maple Catalyst district. So what that means is that we are one of 15 districts in Massachusetts that signed on as one of the 15 founding members. So I just want to kind of give you an idea of what that's all about. So as one of the 15 founding members, you see they're highlighted here on the map, we're districts that are strategically committed to personalized learning and are able to and are willing to share with other districts and their experiences, positive and negative, at implementing the approach to personalized learning. So what this means is that we're really starting to look at and sharing experiences with, and here's the list of the other districts, Arlington, Andover, Beverly, Burlington, Concord, so on. We're with this group of districts that as we begin to look at how we can embed personalized learning, not only with the technology and the strategy and instructional strategies, but we're also looking at collaborating and working with these other districts to find what are the best methods, what are the best software, how do we just do what we're doing better. And so this is a very unique opportunity for us to be part of this unique group of Catalyst districts that are collaborating around these topics. I think it's highly beneficial for the digital learning team. I think it's beneficial for leadership to be involved. And it allows us to really start to set goals with our peers in progress. And I'll just share one other piece of this is our, you know, kind of their definition of personalized learning, just to kind of give a little broader overview. Personalized learning is really focused on developing personalized connections and supporting connections between students, teachers, and adults, developing pathways and allowing students to have a more individual path with their learning, competency-based progression, which often comes through the use of technology, using technology to provide up-to-date assessment of student understanding. Learner profiles, which is something many districts are starting to really get a handle on, is how do we really address the needs of the whole child, and what are those child's needs? And of course, flexible learning environments, and how do we develop environments in which all students can learn with the multidisciplines that they learn with? And of course, technology kind of helps provide the backbone to all of this. So it's looking to how do you look at those multiple areas and address them within your district and develop a pathway and do it in a collaborative way with these other districts. So that's just one of our larger initiatives, and over the course of the year we'll probably be doing, you know, 6 or 7 more events that allow us to collaborate with these districts and bring those skills back to our students. So some of the target areas for this year is, you know, we've initiated the development of a digital learning technology plan that includes the surveying, that also includes some of our involvements for Future Ready, beginning to look at digital learning in a very robust way in the district. We have the new course offerings of the web design and development course, as well as the robotics academy to help support a K-12 STEM pathway. That was a real goal of mine kind of moving in this year, is what are our next steps as we move middle school into high school. Makerspace district development expands. So we've seen an expansion from the Hood Makerspace into now the Little Makerspace, and, you know, and we've begun discussion groups at the Batchelder School around how we're going to start developing that culture of the maker culture in the elementaries. We are also developing a district vision for developing digital learning vocabulary, not only understanding what the personalized learning concepts are about, but also having a general vocabulary that can assist students not only for, you know, while they're doing computer-based testing and understanding digital skills, but also to kind of expand what teachers and students can kind of do to kind of support the digital literacy. And also aligning digital learning staff to support all of these initiatives is a huge component. You know, putting the right people in the right places and having them support all these needs kind of as we kind of keep growing. So some of the elementary curriculum highlights. Our DLSs continue to rotate and focus in the areas of computer science, digital literacy, project-based learning with technology tools as they rotate. Design thinking curriculum is integrated into the maker spaces and supported by the digital learning specialists. The lab spaces have begun to shift. We've seen movement of computers and devices to make additional space for some of the maker spaces in both the Hood School, Little School, and that's a growth process. We try to make as much space for students to, you know, have these types of opportunities while still, you know, doing it in a way that still adapts for some of the demands of technology. And we've also integrated the Clever portal, which expands student access to using Google accounts to district-approved apps. So when a student opens a Chromebook, they are provided a single sign-on to multiple apps that are approved by the district, which kind of not only kind of validates the app that we've decided to use that application, but it also allows students not to have multiple logons and makes us vulnerable to, you know, them having to create passwords. So it's a very streamlined process to minimizing student privacy as we add applications. In terms of middle school, we've had this amazing opportunity to have the 7th grade pilot. I think this is probably the highlight of the year, is really beginning with the benefits of what the one-to-one has really brought to those 7th grade teachers. We have increased use of web-based tools for editing, sharing, and delivering instructional materials. The teachers and the students, I think, have really kind of benefited from having the devices every day in their classroom in terms of their own personal growth, both on the student and teacher side. We have an increased use of collaboration. So many of the projects that they used to do, you know, paper and pencil, they've really adapted very well to moving some of those lessons online, and they're really enjoying the process. And, you know, I just had a meeting with them right before vacation, and I could tell there was a tremendous amount of growth in all of them. They had a great amount to share that I hope to include as kind of the framing of one-to-one personalized learning in the district and the tech plan. We have an increased use of technology to assess student learning through the one-to-one. Teachers have these devices. They're able to implement technology that enables them to do real-time assessment in the classroom, which allows them to differentiate their instruction better right away. I think that's one of the immediate impacts of having devices in the classroom. And additionally, it models digital learning library media support model. So I know you got the pleasure of having the middle school presentation about the one-to-one. I think you saw some of the amazing benefits of having that technology and how that, you know, it's really a work in progress about how we implement these technologies and do it in the most efficient way, especially as we know technology consistently changes. So, you know, embedding some of those content citation skills and some of the key supports that teachers and students need to scale this will be really important. In some of the classrooms with technology, we have some of the digital learning classrooms, they're video to support student instruction with the learning of programming. We also have integrated core concept of programming languages into the curriculum. So what used to be maybe integrated into some of the introductory courses in the high school at a higher scale, we're looking to implement in a much more language-based way, so the students have a starting point for understanding what programming is about through very specific digital vocabulary in middle school, and they've also begun the Institute of Computer Science Club. Additionally, in the high school and the middle school, we've integrated Big Ideas Math with the math teams, which instantly creates kind of an assessment-rich environment for teachers using the devices. And of course, the robotics club's kind of been on the road doing some great presentations at Krista, MassQ, and also with Maple. So it's been an incredible growth year. I feel like, you know, we've all gained a lot through all these different experiences. It keeps it rich, it keeps it growing, and, you know, helps us kind of develop a larger vision for where we want to go for. Some of the highlights in terms of the high school, of course, the updated web design and development course that we hope to implement in the beginning of next year, the Robotics Academy course, and of course, Big Ideas Math integrated through the entire high school with all the high school teachers. So you basically have a one-to-one environment created through that course. And that's been a great way for us to really evaluate how we scale specific applications with an entire curriculum. And we're also in year two of our student technology program change team, which continues to evolve to the needs of the students, which I think is a great thing. And it's constantly adapting to what they kind of want to learn about while still keeping the culture of, you know, technology rich amongst the high school until we kind of get more robust, you know, more courses kind of aligned with each other. And I also think we're positioned to review courses that support a STEAM pathway for students. So now I think we're in a much better position that when we add a course, we start to think about new courses, we can really think about, you know, where are the students coming from in the middle school? What skill levels do they have in the middle school before they get to high school? When they leave grade five, what types of experiences are they gonna have in sixth grade that we really wanna support? So I think that's the big benefit of having some of these new implementations is we can really start to refine that vision and really keep growing with it without, you know, getting too heavy-handed with it as well. So finally, just as next steps, I think, you know, we are prepared to support the grade 4 and 8 computer-based testing, the tech team. So we've been working heavily on just kind of preparing the infrastructure trials and some of the heavy lifting that goes along with that. You know, the next integration of digital learning lesson plans for some of the elementary and middle school teachers to start with, an expanded PD plan to kind of meet those teachers at where they're at with technology. You know, ideally, we'd, you know, like to see co-design lessons between our digital learning specialists and those teachers. Continued development of the elementary digital learning model to support student and teacher development. And that's kind of along the same breath in that we want to see how do we continue to support these teachers in the classroom as well as in digital curriculum blocks. And of course, refining and aligning curriculum from K-5, 6, 8, 9, 12 for digital learning and STEM competency. So really looking at what students are learning at each grade level and addressing it in terms of a competency. And of course, one of the larger things that I think as we move forward is reviewing how we select, deliver, and curate digital curriculum content. That's going to continue to challenge. You know, things are always changing and teachers are always looking for new content. How do we best deliver those content using the devices that we have? And also, how do we select ways of implementing it so that it's streamlined, we're not all in a million places? And prioritize opportunities for teachers' support to utilize new technology in the classroom. Expand and extend understanding of the vocabulary for new opportunities. Utilize and leverage technology to support multiple student-driven learning paths that's kind of aligned with the personalized learning approach, and expand our STEAM digital learning curriculum opportunities for students. So, that's, you know, and I think in the upcoming tech plan, we'll look to kind of bring all these pieces, focus areas to kind of together probably 4 or 5 central areas, and then kind of develop a 5-year vision that kind of supports all of them.
All right. Dr. Downs, what's your current staff for
So I have three digital learning specialists at the elementary. I have a K-12 digital learning specialist who works, you know, she also teaches at the batch, but she does K-12 tech support and she does the robotics club. And then I have a middle school, high school digital learning specialist. And I have a data specialist. And I have a network administrator and myself. So always room for more integration. I mean, it's a challenge. You know, we you know, always trying to meet the teachers where they're at with technology and a good instructional base with getting them to integrate courses is always necessary. So
I had asked a question through John for you about where we're at as a district as far as carts, devices, because I'm worried about equity for our schools. And I know, given the huge changes in makerspaces, and now our labs are kind of dismantled and not running, where are we with devices? Because I know we're requesting quite a bit from CIPC, and I just want to be sure where those are going and what your plans are. And I know you referenced an upcoming tech plan. Do you have an idea of when you'll have that, and will that show us this information?
I can show some of it to you tonight.
Okay.
I would let you know that one of the challenges of the makerspaces was moving things that we'd, so that we, you know, one of the things I kind of like wanted as a big part of that was that we didn't lose computers. Mm-hmm. Specifically, you know, not only because they're still functioning computers and they work, but also to support testing if we need those labs, is also helpful to have 30 computers. So, you know, just to kind of let give a background of that. We actually haven't lost any computers. We just have tried to shift them and move them so that they're in a place to kind of, you know, just so we made extra room. Mm-hmm. And so far, it's working out. You know, I think it's like 50-50 space now. It's a little tighter in the computer areas, but we haven't lost any yet. So I'm very proud that we haven't lost any. Okay. While we still be able to support creating more space for the maker spaces. And I think we're in a middle where we're not really ready to make the full jump to committing a whole space either. I think a lot of the maker space, the teachers utilizing this also like having the technology too. So there's a balance there. Mm-hmm. So let me quickly, I can show you a slide that I have about the devices district wide. So this is our Chromebook iPad breakdown by school. So the Batchelder, you know, you could see pretty much Batchelder, Hood both have 4 carts apiece, total of 120 devices, 30 devices per cart. Well, that's the iPad, sorry, 30 devices, 1 cart. Then we have the little that has 3 carts, a little smaller population. With the middle school, 450 devices with 15 carts, and the high school with 10 carts. And the increase of the high school carts is really dedicated around some of that, the big ideas, math implementation, and some of those larger scaling. And of course, the 15 carts, some of those are for the one-to-one.
Mm-hmm. And are these all purchased with district money, or are these parent?
These are all
donations.
Not sure about the iPads. Was there?
I'm going to guess most of them are district.
Yeah, the majority. There might have been, I would say at most one or two were from a parent, you know, donation, PTO donation.
Carts.
Potentially at the middle school, there might have been one. But the majority of those are district money, district purchased.
There might have been a little bit of
a contribution.
Board?
Yeah.
But
it is.
So what is your plan, you know, if we get the $60,000 from the town, what is your plan for distribution of those?
Is to expand the one-to-one in the seventh grade. To keep doing what we did this year. So
add
to,
I mean, essentially the seventh grade would now have a one-to-one in eighth grade, and you would be adding for the new seventh grade to have a one-to-one.
Right.
Oh, seventh grade stays.
What?
Right.
Right.
Right, but then those seventh graders would be progressing on to eighth grade, and they would be
those ones that they currently have will move up with them too.
So it'll be one to one in eighth grade. That's my question.
But
not next year, in 2 years.
In 2 years.
Can you explain that to me? Right.
Right. So the pilot is the carts in the room.
Sure.
So that'll go to eighth grade. Next year, the seventh graders will get their devices. And then after that, everything moves up. So the carts that were in the eighth grade will then go to the high school, and then you'll have.
But essentially, we'll be having a one-to-one in seventh grade next year as well as eighth grade.
Yes. Essentially.
Okay.
Yep.
But the seventh grade, they'll be able to take them home. They'll be their devices.
The yes.
So the pilot this year enabled those teachers to do the professional development, so to speak, internally to be ready for the full implementation next year.
Right.
Are we working to phase out iPads, given their costs?
They're starting to phase themselves out, yeah. Like the costs are...
Those are older anyway, so...
Yeah. iPad 2s are phasing themselves out. The cost, one iPad is really 3 Chromebooks.
Right.
So, you know, there's still, I think we probably have 2 to 3 years, probably of, you know, integration with iPads, just probably not new devices.
Well, and I think also the iPads for things like video production course and some of those specialty courses,
right.
I think the iPads are more appropriate for that than the Chromebooks and certain applications,
right.
Creative type applications.
Yep. Yep, and you know, the focus really is, you know, to create a robust learning environment that kind of meets as many needs with whatever the largest amount of devices purchased. And then I did include here, you know, just a breakdown of, you know, what we have in the computer labs, Macs, PCs, and desktops. Art and graphic design currently have 30 computers. Engineering have 24 laptops. TV studios have 4 computers. The MIDI lab has 20 here at the middle high. Robotics has 30 at the middle. Digital learning, coding 30 at the middle, and elementaries and business has 60 here for the business department.
Cliff, I just wanted to follow on with that. Julie's question from the CIPC. We've made a large request for funds for wireless infrastructure at the elementary schools. Obviously, we hope we get that. If we don't get that, does that put a crimp in any plans that we have moving forward?
I don't think so, not right now. I think the majority of the place where we're implementing technology is a place that we already are very robust. I think it does, you know, ultimately, you know, 2 years down the line, delay a little bit of more of the classroom integration that we would like to see elementary-wise, but, you know.
It limits our expansion, basically,
yes.
Right? We can't.
Yep.
I think with the increased online standardized testing, we
correct.
We have to.
Right. That's right.
We need that.
That's a high priority.
Mm-hmm.
Just to
yep.
Right.
So without that, you know, we could continue to manage it with a band-aid solution, but if we go to testing at multiple grades like next year, I think that would be really setback.
So there's wireless, but it essentially doesn't work. It's right. Not robust enough.
It can't handle the load that we would be needing.
Right, and it doesn't allow teachers to do what you're doing in a one-to-one in the seventh and eighth grade. That next year, they're not able to teach within their classroom with devices. It does it, and I've already talked to my digital learning specialist about it. It shifts the model when we hopefully ideally would have that kind of connectivity. We'll be working in classrooms more as opposed to kind of centralizing the use of the computers. We try to meet the teachers in their classrooms, which is a different type of integration.
Cliff, I have several questions. First, I did want to make just kind of a general comment. I'm thrilled with the direction we're moving in. It took us a long time to find a digital learning coordinator, a director to put this in place.
At least one that would stay.
At least one that would stay, right? But I'm thrilled with the direction we're going in. Obviously, there's still a lot of work to be done, but I think we're starting to see a plan unfold here. I wonder, on the personalized learning, to me, and maybe this is more John's answer or Patrick, that seems to me to be the future of public education. So I think moving in that direction is really powerful for us to be on the forefront of that. The fact that we're getting involved in being founders of some of these groups, like the Maple Group, not the Maple Group, but the group you mentioned up there.
Go up and
Future
Ready School.
And then the other group where there's 15, Future Ready District. I think that's outstanding. There's only 15 districts in the state participating right now, and that's great to be in the forefront. To take the arrows is sometimes not easy, but down the road it'll benefit us.
Pretty good districts in there too.
Yeah, some really solid districts in there. I also like when the middle school was here a couple weeks ago that we're not shoving one-to-one down the throats of the kids and saying we have to do everything on our computers or nothing at all. It seems to me like we're using them where it makes sense to use them to improve the education process. And I think that seems to be working.
We're not doing it for the sake of doing it.
Right. And I think the personalized learning helps keep that in context too. I mean, I hope that the personalized learning piece of this helps us kind of support the teachers from an instructional standpoint that, you know, we're looking at the learning environments that best, you know, benefit the student as opposed to just the device does all the work, you know, taking a large view at it, you know, from an instructional standpoint. And I think, you know, how the technology supports it's really kind of the key.
So the two questions I have after rambling are, how do we know that either we're succeeding or moving in the right direction? And then the other question is, when you talked about programming and integrating that into the curriculum in the middle schools, are we teaching a specific language or are we just teaching the concepts? Like, are we teaching Python or, you know, what are we?
So what I kind of, I worked with some of those teachers at the beginning of the year, I wanted to set some very simple but definable goals around implementing programming languages into the middle school. We decided, you know, we would either do, you know, Python or JavaScript. It's just a very introduction. But it's really the program, you know, but within that introduction, keying in on the key concepts like, what's an algorithm? What's a variable? How do you make a variable? What's a constant? Some of the consistent language. And the goal with that integration at the middle school is not to have, and I specifically told this teacher, I said, let's have fun with it. Let's have it be something where you can learn some of the vocabulary, what programming is about on that middle school level, so that when you get to that freshman year, when you get to that sophomore year where you have the potential of taking a programming class and learning more about it and getting deeper, these are not all new foreign concepts to you. You've learned the basics of these things and how they work together, and you've had fun with it, you've enjoyed it, you've done at least one unit in it, so you have a little bit of experience so that if you decide to, I want to go more towards web development or I want to go more towards robotics, at least they have some of the core background so that the programming piece is not necessarily as intimidating.
Right, and that those are all transferable regardless of what language or what you're programming. Right. All of those concepts are involved regardless of what you're doing. So
yeah, so just, you know, and that's kind of the goal with the language is just to kind of build a backbone for students of just understanding and bringing into the forefront, and this is important. If you want to have more opportunities in it, this is what they could look like.
And how are we measuring success? What does that look like?
So that's a big question amongst one of the 15 catalyst districts, and that's like actually one of the larger right now for myself. When I look at what is success with, it's really how well do we have these deliverables? How well do we streamline things? I think cost always becomes an issue with the software. You know, we want to resist like overspending and all that. You know, how can we kind of develop a streamlined way of, you know, integrating digital curriculum into the classroom that doesn't, like, you know, cost too much and also at the same time is the best interest of the students? And that's been a topic with this 15 district catalyst district of using different implementation tools. And from a conversation I had with Ken Clough, the director of digital learning with the state, he's looking towards putting together kind of a playbook for personalized learning in the state, and using these catalyst districts as kind of the reservoir of information about how we've begun doing that, to kind of also develop assessment models for what does successfully look like in these schools. And, you know, and just from talks with Westford, there's several different ways of measuring success with teachers. I mean, we had a one-to-one meeting last Friday, and I asked them just to share with me what they really gained from this experience. And, it, you know, I try to lay it out in that slide. Increased use in web-based applications, streamlining how they're assessing student learning, differentiating instruction based on that assessment, you know, getting closer to kind of identifying the individual needs of students. So right now, I think those are the first seeds of success, is really getting a better understanding of what each student really needs, you know, in the classroom. And then our next step is really refining how we use it and getting better, and you know, the focus on being the instructional classroom as opposed to the device dominating what's the device. The device is really like a means to assisting us in instructing using different tools.
Two more quick comments. I don't know if you've looked at the iRobot STEM program that they have. And also, are you familiar with the Science from Scientists program?
No.
You should check that out. It's run by, it's the wife of the guy who's the CEO of iRobot,
okay.
Co-founder and CEO. And they bring scientists into buildings. And, you know, kids kind of get excited because, okay, well, these are real science. And I know we've had some at the high school on some of the, but it's a great program, mainly focused in Massachusetts, but they're now expanding to Minnesota, I think, California, they're now getting into. But I think it might be helpful to us. We might be able to bring them in here.
Oh, and we've had talks with that. I know they visited before, so we might just have to reconnect on those contacts. And okay. The STEAM, you know, that's the great thing about hosting that STEAM summit. Like, what do we do next year? Who can we invite? How can we, you know, take that day and have an opportunity to kind of bridge those connections again and then just keep making them stronger? So thanks. I appreciate everything. Thank you.
Cliff, I just have another
Cliff.
Comment.
Julie?
Kind of piggybacking on what Mel said, while I appreciate and value the networking that we're doing and, you know, trying to be kind of at the forefront of a lot of these things, I still think we need to kind of look on the smaller level, the student level, and I feel that kind of you know, not really having a concrete tech plan to look at and really be able to look at what competencies and skills we're asking of a kindergartner, of a second grader. I see a lot of projects happening, but I don't necessarily know what my second grader is learning for digital learning skills. And I think communicating that with parents is very important to kind of then support, you know, the purchasing, the integrating of these devices to kind of integrate curriculum. So I think that's something that I would like to see more of, and I see it as a next step, refining and aligning the curriculum. But I think if you could do a little bit more, connecting with the teachers, principals, in that regard, I think would be
of having them share some of what's happening in their buildings with those?
Yes, and I don't necessarily think, I mean, because we visit the schools, we see these great projects, but I really don't know what competencies and skills are being addressed at each grade level. And I think, I don't know if that's just because I'm a certified tech specialist and that's what I'm looking for, but the teacher in me wants to know what's the standard.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's,
you know, are the teachers assessing those standards?
Well, that's part of, you know, our growth with our model. I mean, I think last year, just, you know, getting everyone, it was everyone's first year, getting, I think we did a lot of work with our curriculum about creating actionable objectives in the classroom. Mm-hmm. And they did a great job with that. And now we're in year, you know, now we're in that next year where we've just adopted new digital learning computer science standards. And that's part of, you know, where I see the digital learning lesson plans and expanded PD. We work within a system right now that's very, we have the digital learning block, and we ask our digital learning specialists also to go into the classroom, mm-hmm. which is great. And it provides great opportunities for teachers who want to integrate in the classroom and also have a specific digital learning block where they get specific skills. But we're still working towards where we're trying to bring full integration on both sides. You know, if a digital learning teacher is teaching a class, you know, the teacher is growing with that growth of the class, sure. as well. If they're going into the classroom and teaching the teacher, that's a different type of growth for the teacher who's then integrating with, and hopefully that teacher is eventually growing on their own and integrating. So I think right now we're doing a lot of different things that that with expanded connection, we're gonna see teachers even grow more. So I definitely think we could, and it's been a thought on my mind too, like really sharing out some of the, you know, not only the great projects, but having people understand what's behind them. I think that's sure. a big part of it too, as well. So. I definitely see that as well.
Anything else? Jerry?
Nope. Mr. Bowers, if I could just, I want to, Dan has done a very nice job with his team. Really, it hasn't been an awfully long time that you've been here. It was a year in October. Really putting North Reading on the map locally at the state level and at the federal level. And I want to thank you, Dan, for the good work you're doing. Patrick, you too. I mean, you two work very closely together with the digital learning team, and I think some really good things are going on in our schools, and I think the future is very bright. So thank you.
No, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a little bit of a comment. I think that the key is to have the kids working with digital. Just you start working with it, and after a while, you kind of expand on that. I never had a computer class ever, but I started with an IBM PC-1, and I do pretty well with it. And I think when I know when the computer is appropriate to use and when it isn't appropriate to use. I still can use the pen. I still do math in my head, simple math. But it's a tool that you get to use, and I think if you're using it, you grow in it. It becomes one of these things, basically, and I think that's important that we get to the kids at an early age, because earlier is better. Yeah. Just watch one of the grandchildren teach grandma mm-hmm. how to use the device that she's been using for 3 years. And show her new tricks with it.
And I've appreciated the opportunity in North Reading, you know, being with people who support these tools on, you know, K through 5, 6 through 8. That's not happening everywhere, where there's a commitment. I really feel a sense of commitment towards, you know, enabling students to grow with these tools and support them, and looking at it from a perspective of how, you know, how can we teach better with them. I think, you know, that doesn't you don't have that opportunity, I think, everywhere to kind of take that kind of nurturing approach and have the support for it. So I really appreciate all your support.
Well, I do think one thing that's important is, you know, some of our kids might be referred to as digital natives, but they truly aren't. So, you know, mine, they're older. You know, they had computers when they were 8, 9, 10, you know, 11, they started using computers. But the kids that are now entering school are, and I hate the term digital natives, but they are true digital natives. These are kids who've been using this stuff almost from day one. And I think we have to be prepared as an education system, not just North Reading, to deal with that. To because those kids have different requirements than we had or our kids have.
Different level and a different reason,
exactly.
Too. That's the whole
exactly.
thing is for what our kids
right.
grew up.
I mean, they can get access to information so much easier. They just seem to be able to, you know, reason and rationalize better than maybe we could because of that access to information.
And I think the misconception sometimes is, oh, well, they know how to do these things.
Right, right.
Well, do they know how to do it
right.
in a way that's
exactly.
appropriate? Are they citing reference? You know, like, you know, those are very important skills that they're not getting. So
right.
that's and our job as the educators.
It is a challenge. It is a challenge to stay ahead of those students and teach to the way that, you know, they're going to be open and receptive to learning.
Right.
You know, the students are changing, but we're always adjusting and looking, you know, and I think that's where the challenge comes in is how do we best meet them, you know, and meet the teachers too. I think it's just like meeting the teachers, getting them engaged around these topics is essential as well.
Anything else? Thank you very much.
Thanks,
Dan.
Thank you.
All right, and now we're on to minutes.
I will make a motion to approve the January 23rd, 2017 executive session as written.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
I also make a motion to approve the January 23rd, 2017 regular session meeting minutes as written.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
And I will make a motion to approve the February 6, 2017 executive session minutes as written.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And then on the February 6th, there's one correction on the February 6th, 2017 regular meeting on page 4. The last date under future business is wrong. I don't know. It says February 27th, but it should be, I think, April something. We have two meetings.
It should be April 10th, I believe.
Okay.
That's a Monday.
That is.
Is it? Yeah.
So with that correction, I move to approve.
That's the public hearing on the budget, April 10th. Yeah.
Yes,
second.
Correct. These minutes.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. And now on to Mr. Connolly, budget update.
Very good. Thank you. So the February budget update was included in your packet this evening. It reflects financial activity through the month of January, and I will say there's not a lot of new information or that has arisen since the January update. A lot of the same drivers and that we've been discussing over the last couple of months are certainly ring true with this report. On the expense side of the report, you'll notice there is again some available funds in the out-of-district tuitions account, really resulting in the fact that we exceeded our budgeted prepayments at the end of fiscal 16, as I've suggested, so leading to some a surplus in that account at the moment. That will help us address any unforeseen costs, you know, should we need to do so. On the utility side of the equation, we have encumbered all utility expenses, and I reported in the past, I still anticipate that we're going to spend the majority of our electricity budgets this year. So far, I think there could be a small surplus on our gas budget, but we'll continue to monitor that as we move through the heating season. We've discussed in the past, and I'll just highlight that we are anticipating or experiencing higher maintenance costs throughout the district, in particular at the high school, middle school campus this year, particularly around HVAC issues, et cetera. So we have been able to manage these costs to date, but we'll certainly monitor those costs closely as we move through the second half of this fiscal year. We've been talking a little bit about the food service program throughout this fiscal year, as we've had in the past. You heard from Chartwell's this evening, and I'm happy to report that they closed out the month of January with a small profit. And the numbers through this year to date, as you saw earlier, are significantly less than we were at this time last year. So we've lost $7,519 through the month of January. This is an encouraging sign for the program. As you know, the goal is to reduce this loss the remaining 5 months of the school year and break even, and I think that's a realistic goal at this point. On the payroll side of the financials, you may recall we were a little bit more aggressive in what our budgeted savings were for staff turnover and attrition. So as a result, I think you're seeing a smaller projected balance in some of the salary accounts, in particular the teacher account, than we have seen in the past. I will note that, as I said in the past, to date there has been less of a need than we've experienced the last few years, and the trend of appointing long-term substitutes to fill extended leave of absences, and that is leading to a projected surplus at the moment in the substitute accounts. But for the most part, payroll projections are very close to budgeted amounts. So that being said, I'll turn it over to any questions by the committee. There's a couple other things I do want to speak to this evening as well.
Any questions? Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. So I did want to highlight as in the evening.
Are you coming up?
Yeah. I did want to highlight this evening some updates on the booster. I know there was a school committee goal this year to receive periodic updates on the booster policy, relations with booster and support organizations. And I'm happy to report that, I think everything has been going very well. We're certainly in compliance with the policy LEC, relations with booster and support groups. The support organizations that we're working with are certainly complying with the guidelines that we presented to them a couple years ago when we rolled out this revised policy and guidelines. We have not seen this fiscal year any new groups come forward that we've been working with, but what we have seen, so we still have 12 groups that are officially recognized, and out of those 12 groups that are noted on our website, which I'll pull up in a moment, those are the major parent organizations and athletic booster and support groups that we've been working with. And these organizations are, from my opinion, are in compliance. If there's been any changes in leadership or major changes with their account information, these organizations have sent in a renewal application this year with their updated information. So I think things are proceeding well, and certainly districts are, these organizations are in compliance. So one of the things I was just going to draw your attention to, just so you are aware, is on the website under the business office tab on the district administration website, there is a link that brings you to the booster and support group information. Here it talks a little bit about a policy that we passed a couple years ago, and it does list the 12 organizations that the school committee has officially voted to recognize right here on our website for the public and for everyone's knowledge. And then some of the links over here are not only some helpful information for support organizations to access, you can also, the links to our regulations and our policies here, and some helpful information and presentations that I've been giving in the past are here. And then the actual application, should anyone wish to apply to be officially recognized, any new organization is there, and this is a fillable PDF that can be completed right here online. So I am pleased with how things have been progressing. I think we're in you know, this is the full second year of this policy being in full effect.
So Mike, can you pull that out so we can see the whole list?
Yes.
So I don't know where these groups would fit, but we have groups that raise, one particularly that raises a lot of money, the Maskers, yet they don't have to be part of, I know that it's
a school-based club.
So the Maskers is a student a club. So I'm going to talk a little bit about student activity clubs. And
yeah, but so that's my question. So how are we, so I don't see, for example, cheerleaders up there, but I see cheerleaders collecting money at the grocery store or Dunkin' Donuts. I understand this, but I don't understand, you know, Maskers has kids going around door to door to collect money for their program book. I don't have a problem with that, but how are we regulating those?
So the difference is, so these are our outside organizations.
Right.
So these are outside booster groups, parent organizations. The difference is these organizations need to have their own tax-exempt number, their own federal identification number. They're a separate entity, separate from the schools. They function by their own set of bylaws, their own mission statement. And there's obviously that collaboration that exists in terms of our guidelines, and if they're going to be working as part of a mission to support and supplement a lot of the things we're doing as an organization, as a school department, we want to be aware of that and have that partnership, which I think was what we established with the policy. The other organizations that you're speaking of, those are, for instance, the Maskers, that is a student activity, a high school student club. So that is, governed out of a very, separate, they're part of the North Reading Public Schools. They're part of our, tax exempt number that we have with the town. So, they're governed under kind of a separate set of regulations as a school sponsored club or activity. So
how do they report? So example, these people have to report how much they're raising.
And, they do.
And if I came to you, you could give me a report on all of these, right? Basically.
So the policy states that these organizations have to keep a very detailed set of financial statements. Upon request by myself or the superintendent or the school committee, they have to submit to us their financial statements, as well, upon request. We didn't require that, and we had a discussion on this a couple of years ago. So that I'm very confident with the data they have sent to me. They do submit a list of the fundraisers every year with their renewal application that they're looking to conduct, as well as some of their mission and their goals, that they're in good standing and they're tracking and they're in good standing with their financial statements and their tax returns with what they need to do as an organization. The Maskers, as a school activity club, the club advisors and student leaders of a club or a team, athletic coach as well, they need to submit any fundraising activities through the high school principal, which then comes down to our office and the district office. Once approved, we file those, keep record of the organizations that, so there is a process of these fundraisers to be approved through the administration, and those are kept record in the district office. And in terms of their financial activities, those are overseen by not only the club advisor and through the high school principal's office, but then as well as my office. So we reconcile their work and work very closely with the club advisor and the high school principal's office to monitor the revenue and the expenses and the ins and outs of their club. And then we are required, that financial activity does get audited by the district as an independent audit annually as part of the policy.
So do you get information on how much they've raised, how much they've spent?
Yeah, I have all that. Mm-hmm. So that's all.
Because I know in the past, and I'm not saying anything nefarious has gone on here, but it's been kind of a loose system of keeping track of all this.
But the real distinction, these groups.
Right, these groups.
We don't control them.
Right.
Correct.
We do control policies and procedures to do business with them, but we don't control them. The others we control.
Right. We control. Right. Yeah.
So it's up to us to
every system has been very every tight club, for half a dozen years.
Okay.
Yeah. Every club advisor has to submit a request for an expenditure that flows through the principal's office as well as my office to request an expenditure out of one of their accounts.
So that's tighter than it used to be, and because
correct
in the past, and again, nothing nefarious, but they'd be like, oh, this person has $600 in the safe from this club. And I'd be like, well, wait a minute, that's not, But yep. I know we're not doing that anymore.
So this is...
It's been several years.
Yeah.
And Michael, I think just emphasize the audit, would you?
Yeah.
I will, yeah. So part of my other comments tonight, and again, on the web, on the district website, talks a little bit about student activity accounts, and we listed on this, listed here is the operations manual that is governed by our policy. The link to the school committee policy is here. And I will say that this student activity fund staff training presentation.
That's good.
So this PowerPoint is giving on an annual basis to the club advisors. I stand before the club advisors in this room at the beginning in the fall of every year and go through this PowerPoint and talk about the general principles and the state laws, things to be aware of from accounting principles, operating procedures, talk about some of the highlights of that procedure manual, how to handle receipts and expenses, common mistakes to avoid, and then I take their questions.
That's great.
So this, you know, I talk a little bit about cash handling and how to handle receipts and the importance of turning over all receipts within 24 hours of fundraising activities. So I will say, I think it's certainly helped a lot, and I think the key to continuing it to ensure things don't, you know, sit in drawers or safes longer than they should is just ongoing training. What I found, you can't do enough training. And you know, it's constant to try to ensure that everyone understands, you know, the procedures, and it's really a protection for of them as an individual. And I think the word's gotten out, particularly over the last few years.
I agree.
And I'm pleased with you know, the response and how the staff is responding to Excellent. The procedures. I am.
Before you get out of there, can you go back to the homepage of our school website?
Yeah,
I was hoping Dan could get something in the paper on this week. Michael's done a great job. You see FY18 school budget video, and it's been put on Facebook a couple times. But he goes through about a 15-minute video explaining the budget, how the process works, chapter, the whole nine yards. And and I'm hoping that as we go along with the process, you might be able to do new videos, shorter, you know, explaining
so
where
we can educate some people
yes,
on our budget.
Exactly.
That's the goal.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep.
And these are great. There's another, I think there's another one up there too.
There is. So there's two here. They also can be found under the budget link. So we made them a little bit more easy to find. So there was one done about some preliminary challenges of what we're facing in the budget, a little bit more information about the state budget and where some of the challenges they're facing at the state level, as well as key dates in our capital budget. And then this one was particularly focused towards Chapter 70 and how the Chapter 70 program works. And so I think that's the goal, and this was, again, this was the school committee goal to, I think you're right, I think they have to be a little bit shorter, right? I think each video is about 15 minutes, which was about 5 or 6 minutes longer than I wanted them to be. I went a little bit longer.
But you can, so. I mean, if you want to move through them,
you can edit,
move through them
move
and go
through
to
it. Yeah.
So, but I just wanted to make sure that people are aware. It's been on Facebook, but I think it's a great resource for people to understand the budget and how it works, how state aid works, et cetera.
Yeah, I think we have a couple more ideas for some topics in the future, so we'll be adding to that. Right.
That's especially important at this time of year as we're really getting into the hardcore budget issues.
We'll see our budget presented next week, so
preliminary budget. Yeah.
Yeah. If people are going to come to that meeting, they might want to watch the video in advance and give them a good background on what we're going to talk about.
Right. Very good. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you, Michael.
And the difference between a few years ago and today is we're no longer keeping money in the shoebox.
Correct.
Under the bed.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to say the website, it's so improved over where it was a few years ago. It's stuff is easier to find. It's updated. You know, I went there today to just make sure I saw the agenda. I posted it on the North Reading Community Connection so people know. You know what we're talking about tonight. It's everything's
filled
there.
Filled up the room.
Yeah, it did. Filled up the room.
You would have had two less people.
I mean, the line, as Mr. Trump would say, the line is six blocks outside there to get in here. And
that's where it starts.
Exactly.
Blocks out.
If I could, Mr. Bowers, just quickly
Certainly.
On the website, we are also exploring the possibility of an app for the district.
A mobile app.
So
I've talked to Patrick.
Dr. Daly and I have a meeting scheduled shortly. I'm not sure we're going to be able to afford to do it, but we at least are exploring that, and I think there could be some benefits.
I showed him the one that the Haverhill School District
Correct.
Has,
we've
pretty good.
We've kind of looked at it, quite honestly, we've looked at it for the last 2 years, but it's always been a bit of a financial right. consideration that we haven't yep. undertaken.
Exactly. Cause,
and we don't know if we're going to be able to again, but this is a different vendor, and so it's something we're looking at.
Because I know Jerry's been dying to get that on his flip phone.
Yes, he has been nagging me about that.
My daughter says the other day, you have 200 messages on your phone.
And you didn't know.
I think 190 are from me.
He knows. He knows, but he from Cindy, he knows, but he can't five access
from,
them.
From Cliff. Thank you.
We have nothing further on that. We go on to staffing. There's none. There's nothing to report on that and take action on.
Correct.
Next item on our agenda is bids and donations, and we have five very nice donations. You want to do the honors
sure.
again and go through these?
Absolutely. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a recommendation that the school committee vote to accept with gratitude a $100 donation from Stephen and Adrian Tingley to support costs associated with the 8th grade Washington, D.C. trip.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. Unanimous. Next one.
I'd like to make a motion that the school committee vote to accept with gratitude a donation from the North Reading Touchdown Club of $480.10 to purchase new football jerseys.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a recommendation that the school committee vote to accept with gratitude a total donation of $945 from middle school parents listed above to offset the costs associated with the 8th grade Washington, D.C. trip.
Do we need to?
Do I need to?
Name them all?
Name them? I will. Yeah. I will.
Probably should. Okay.
Rogerio Silva and Adriana Grego of $50. James and Barbara Thorstad, $50. Richard and Carrie Brick, $25. James and Judith Brown, $50. Christine Bird, $25. David and Geraldine Rinaldi, $200. Czar.
Come on, Julie.
And Gulara.
Yara.
Very good.
Reskanov. Reskanov, yes. $50.
The last time
good
she makes
you.
Nasima Elias, $50. Philip and Carolyn Coppolis, $250. Deanna Capone, $50. David and Kathleen Danis, $20. Christopher and Andrea Hansen, $25. And Stephen and Lauren Kay, $100.
Yeah, it's pretty generous because that goes generally, right, to help
yeah.
defer the cost for
yeah.
kids that maybe.
Right.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
You're good.
Unanimous.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a recommendation that the school committee vote to accept with gratitude a donation from Fit Revolution of $1,959.66 for two new basketball backboards at the Hood Elementary School.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
I think the old ones are in pretty rough shape up there, so it's
much needed.
Yeah,
that's good. That's
great
good.
Donation.
That's great.
Want to do the big one?
Mm, go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that the school committee vote to accept with gratitude a humongous donation.
What does it say that?
At $65,607.58 from the Ethel Little School PTO to support funding a fantastic new program, playground at the little school.
A lot of money.
I think seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And should note the total that they've donated for this project is $100,067.58. And I believe it's going to be underway soon, correct, Michael?
Yes. Yeah, so that completes their fundraising efforts for this project. So we'll be able to, with this acceptance, process the final purchase orders to the firm, the company, and they will be ordering the equipment this week. It should come in at the middle of April, and they're due to begin the installation just after the April vacation week, so.
Congratulations.
Underway.
Yeah, it's
little school PTO.
Great effort. I know many members of the community have been incredibly generous and donating to them for this. So.
These donations are all just incredible. Every week we have, every meeting, we have another batch of very generous donations, and very, very much appreciated by the committee, and shows the interest of the community in the student for the school.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would just, if I could just add, I echo your sentiments exactly. I mean, it's wonderfully generous. There is a dedication for the little school playground scheduled for May 12th, Friday, May 12th at 3 o'clock. But I'll certainly remind the committee of that, and I'm sure there'll be more notification coming out of the little school as that date nears. But
well, the good news,
mark your calendar for now.
Good news is they shouldn't have to worry about a varsity softball game being played over there on that day.
I would hope not.
Hopefully they'll be playing up here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Subcommittee updates. Athletic subcommittee.
Athletic subcommittee, first item on the agenda was the FY17 athletic revolving account budget update. And Michael, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think at the end of fiscal 2017, we're going to be pretty much down to zero.
$3,000 maybe? $3,000.
So it's pretty much exhausted as a result of various things that we've done throughout the year. We're still looking at a deficit of, again, correct me, Mike, if I'm wrong with the number, but about $22,822 for the so-called gift account for the money that we received through donations to build the to do the irrigation and the sod at the softball field and the all-purpose field. So we're trying to still raise money to make that up. I met with Chuck Carucci and Dan Brown the other day, and we're talking about, I don't know if they contacted you, John.
No.
But we were trying to look at April 28th as our first fundraiser for the benefit of the fields. That was going to be a Las Vegas night, and we thought April 28th, we tried to clear it with everybody to see if there was anything else going on that night. It's a Friday night. Mm-hmm. So I think that's something, Mel, that we'll propose at the next Athletic Facilities Committee meeting.
Right.
Is to do the first fundraiser on April 28th, try to get the word out. Try to get as much participation as possible, and the money raised from that fundraiser will be dedicated to, again, paying back some of the money that's owed to the school department for the money they loaned us, as well as buying some things for the field. I think our first priority that we talked about was getting the gates and the bleachers and the dugout enclosures for the softball field, if we can do that so that the spring season. And in a minute, I know it's not on the agenda, athletic facilities.
Well, I was going to bring that up with you after you were done. Yeah,
that's what I was going to do. I was just going to turn it over to you when I'm finished. The only other things we talked about was the Reading YMCA, the swim rates for 2017-18, where our swim team practices and competes, I think are going up significantly, but Mike's in the process of negotiating with the Y to see if we can reduce those
rates based
on the quid pro quo that we have with them here
at Reading. Leave it out. I'll have a positive update on that respect at the next meeting. We made some significant progress, very good progress with the YMCA on that.
Because it was going to result in a significant cost, increased cost to continue to practice there, but hopefully that gets worked out.
We believe it has been.
Oh, good. The Diamond Club has proposed, and I think the athletic director has approved, a perimeter fence to be installed for this coming season at the baseball field.
I think so. We did talk about it. I think Eric Archambault, the coach, had a meeting scheduled for last Thursday with the groups to meet, but it's moving in the direction of...
It's a fence that they're proposing go inside the permanent fence on the baseball field for basically a home run fence. And it goes into to slots so that it can be removed and taken out.
Right. They put holes in the ground. They put in...
Sleeves.
And they put the fence in, and then when the season's over, they take the fence out. So
it's
just there.
The coach wanted to do
the baseball season.
Be there for baseball season, or it could be taken out if you need it for anything else, whether you need it for the javelin. We won't need that with the new fields, et cetera. Let me see. I think that's pretty much it. The one thing I do want to get, some more detail on is this so-called fundraiser, because it's going to be important that we get the word out and we get a participation.
And even though it's not on the agenda, we have scheduled an athletic facilities meeting for this Thursday at 7 o'clock here, where we will hear the final plan and proposal that hopefully gets put forward at the special town meeting. It should get put forward. We have CBI coming in to give us the plan and the projected cost for a bathroom facility And then also gave us a cost for a, to put a concrete slab in there to accommodate a concession stand down the road. Our goal would be, if this gets approved at special town meeting, is to, when we put out to bid, we will put it out to bid. The main bid will be for the restroom facility. The concrete slab will be an alt add. We'll get prices on that, but we aren't required to spend the money for that. So I'm assuming we're going to put a set amount of money. There'll be a set amount of money on the warrant item. I'm not assuming there will be a set amount of money in the warrant item. And we will have, if we want to do both things, we'll have to fit them within that money. And if we can't, we'll only be able to do the restroom aspect.
The warrant's already printed for the special town meeting.
Correct.
So Article 5 is the bathroom article.
Right.
And there are the various options. Every option's open as to how to fund it.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's something this committee has to take a look at and consider prior to the town meeting as to how we would recommend it be funded, because there are various options that have been thrown out there, including using some free cash, bonding. There's all, every funding option is available to us. So I think that's something we're going to have to decide as to how we want to move forward.
I've spoken with Town Administrator Mike Gilberto, and I'll be presenting this at the special town meeting, just a few slides. I'm not going to go way into the background. I'm going to give a little background why we didn't need it before and why we need it now, because the school's not there anymore. And the fact that we do have a waiver, but we don't have forever to get this done. We need to put restroom facilities at that field within the next year or two, or we're not going to be able to.
We're pretty sure the cost isn't going to go down.
Right, the cost is definitely not going down.
The other thing is that I don't want to call it a compromise, but based on the discussions we've had with everybody, we've fallen back to this less expensive, I think, option, which is basically to take down the existing concession stand, build this bathroom facility at that location without a concession stand, but with the option of a future concession stand there. And that hopefully the cost of that is going to be something that's palatable to the town.
We'll come in within the budget that we have to work with.
Yes. And as I've mentioned before, I think the administration, the athletic department, Parks and Rec will work with the groups that use the field and also work with our health inspector to figure out what can they sell there. You know, if they can put up a tent, and what kind of concessions can they sell in the interim until we have a more permanent solution.
And just as one final note on that, the fields, the irrigation, the sod, concession stand, the bathroom facility, it's a town project. It's not a school project.
Right.
It's a combination of the schools and the town mutually trying to and collaborate together to get this thing done, because both are going to benefit and both are using all the facilities.
Yeah, everybody pretty much is all in on, they were all in on that sod and the irrigation project. Great cooperation.
It looks great.
Right, it's going to be great.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's going to be, the town is going to be able to use that, softball and other sports, you know, the smaller kids in the youth sports, some of the, you know, soccer, if they need it. But soccer has a great facility now over at McGuire Field, so.
We need to raise some more money. We need to pay back the school department. We also need to raise some money to buy equipment for those fields. So
right.
We have our work cut out for us.
Yep.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I could just have two updates on related to the athletic subcommittee of things that have been talked about at past meetings and that have kind of come about in the last few days. There's a meeting tomorrow. The athletic director is meeting tomorrow with a contractor about the installation of the discus pad.
Oh, yeah.
So that meeting's happening tomorrow. And I also asked him to work with the contractor to cost out a removal of the, I'll call it the temporary pad that had been installed in the corner of the baseball field in the interim of the middle high school being built. The second thing is Marty Tilton called me last week following up on a topic that's come up at one or two athletic subcommittee meetings.
Gooses?
About the geese, yeah.
Oh, the geese, yeah.
I thought they were goose.
Yeah, so he has researched, interestingly enough, and we will do some informational promotion of this when the time comes, and when I tell you what it is, you'll understand why. He has come to the conclusion that a starter pistol might be the best solution to, I'll say, scare the geese away. He's researched like a noise-activated, you know, whether it's a siren or something. Like that. The reports on those are not very favorable, but that the starter pistol, which is kind of an orange plastic pistol, and he's working with the police department to get an approval through the safety officer for the use of that. He wanted to know what my thoughts were on it, and I told him I thought as long as we advertised, it's not 100% certain yet, Dan, but it's coming, I think, as a way to try to mitigate.
He or someone would come up there when the geese are there, and eventually the geese won't come back anymore because they think they're getting shot at, right?
That's the thought.
Because it is a pro, it's becoming a big problem.
On the softball field, it is. A lot of gooses down there. There really are.
It's a problem.
But we would, if that is what we decide to do, it's something we would promote in the community so that people, if they heard it, would know what the sound was. But they're on the property a lot. They really are, even up the road and on the side.
I was going by the other day and I said, oh, look, a gander. Anyway.
Okay, Mosh.
Moving on.
Three Stooges.
Finance.
I got it.
Finance planning team met on February 16th. You want to start that?
Sure. As you can imagine, we talked about budget, and based on the current revenue numbers as of that day. What date was that?
16th.
The 16th.
Yeah. As of that date, based on the revenue that we had, the school department on their level services budget was looking at a $779,000 deficit. And the town was looking at a $212,667 deficit going into next fiscal year based on those revenue numbers. We talked about, various options that were available to us. The biggest thing that seems to be controlling, not the only thing, but the biggest thing controlling the budget, the available revenue, is the health insurance. We seem to be all over the map on that. They built in this budget that the revenues that we're looking at includes a 7.5% increase in health insurance costs. That equates to about $55,000 per percentage point. But we're even higher than the 7.5 based on the last meeting that we had. I think we're around 10.5.
Correct.
Selectmen tonight are actually, I think, seeing a presentation a health insurance consultant or whoever.
Yeah, that's right.
That's trying to present to them something that may be a lot lower than 10.5 and may even be lower than 7.5%. So potentially we could actually save some money or add some revenue to the available budgets. The town is still negotiating some of their contracts. They've got a salary pool built in. We have a salary pool on the contracts that are being negotiated. The snow and ice budget as of I think before the last two storms,
I
bet it's gone.
They had some money, but now
they had a surplus of about $152,000. I'm guessing that's probably gone. There is $450,000 in free cash that's been thrown around. I think some people on the Board of Selectmen and on the Finance Committee are advocating that money be used to pay in part the bathroom facilities. Others have talked about using that as a one-year bridge to get through the fiscal year as part of adding it to the budget deficit. Let me see. We talked about the Berry property again, and that's obviously town meeting. The warrant includes a number of zoning changes that will accommodate the Berry property purchase. There will be funds exchanged, I think, sometime relatively soon at a closing.
Before the end of the year, I think.
So that money is going to be available to do with, I think, whatever the town decides to do with it. There probably won't be a significant gain from taxes until the first phase of construction is done. They're going to phase this in over a period of 4 or 5 years. But I think there will be some tax revenue just from the fact that the land will now be owned by a private.
They'll pay tax on the land and the value of the land, which is they're paying $30 million.
Right.
So.
So I'm not sure, Cliff, what else we
have. That sounds like it's pretty close to it. The sum of it is that the town finances are way behind. Expenses for the next year are looking like they're a lot larger than revenues anticipated. And that's going to create a lot of consternation between now and town meeting.
And all the deficits that we've talked about are basically using our level services budget as our baseline, not our enhanced budget.
Well, I know the level services thing throws a lot of people off, but I'm not going to reveal details, but I know we've had a larger than expected enrollment so far for kindergarten, which requires us to add more staff. People don't understand. So that's a level service. Level services, we make sure that every student who wants to go to public kindergarten can go to public kindergarten.
We have to do it for half day kindergarten.
Well, that's my point. Yeah. And if we don't add that staff, we don't have enough teachers and paras to teach the kindergarten courses. So that's level services. If we have 50 kids 1 year and 150 the next year, we're going to have maybe 4 staff 1 year and 8 staff the next year.
Correct.
That's level services.
And it's tough because if they see the actual overall enrollment number go down a little bit, that seems to equate to a reduction in staff. It doesn't because of the shifts in enrollment from different
grades. Well, and because it's spread over 12 grades.
Right.
So if you have 50 fewer kids over 12 grades.
That's correct.
Unless, you know, a big chunk of those are in one elementary school.
Yeah. Right.
And we reduced staff a couple of years ago at the middle school, correct?
Middle school, two.
Two staff.
Two staff.
Yeah. Was there anything else?
I think we talked a little bit about the little school roof, which I have as part of my report tonight, too.
Yeah, it's still on.
I think you got the sum and substance. Yeah, the roof is still on.
I think the bulk of the meeting was on the financial condition.
Yeah, I mean, it's just we go back and forth, and I will say this, that there was a little bit more available revenue this time around than there was the prior meeting, but then again, we had added a little bit to our our budget, too, because of the kindergarten situation. So I think we had added
one and a half
positions.
So, 1.5, right?
1.5 positions, yeah.
It was dismal.
Yeah.
The evaluation subcommittee met on February 22nd.
So we met, Janine, John, and I, to kind of discuss our timeline for the school committee self-evaluation, as well as John's superintendent's evaluation. Can you just take a minute past the rest? So we have a proposed timeline. We're going to have a very busy month of March on top of our budget responsibilities. We will be presenting the documents that you'll need to complete the evaluations next week at our March 6th meeting. Tentatively, we have right now a March 23rd deadline for submission of our self-evaluation. We will be meeting as an evaluation subcommittee to compile the results and have an open discussion and presentation on April 10th, 2017. Janine, do you want to talk a little bit about the superintendent evaluation or?
Just that once the evaluation goes out, Mr. Bernard will have his
binder,
thank yeah. you, ready at his office for you guys to go in and, you know, take a look, see at it. And
do we have to, or is that optional?
It's totally optional. I'm going to take it home.
Depends on the evaluation.
A thorough go through on it. So, and then, you know, the same thing, the timeline of getting it back to me, I believe, is on the 27th. And
correct.
Then I will present on the 6th.
Yeah. Actually, I think the evaluation subcommittee will compile the results.
On the 6th. Oh,
sorry.
Public discussion is May 1st.
On May 1st. Thank you.
So the difference is I'm kind of heading our self-evaluation, and Janine's kind of heading the superintendent evaluation, just because it's a lot in a short period of time.
I'm not going to look at that binder. I like to rank John based on my gut feeling. What about you, Jerry?
That's okay with it. I'm okay with it. I'm just going to give a 91 no matter what.
Ladies, if you don't mind, if I could add that, sure. I think this schedule was crafted in such a way so as to make sure that this existing committee was intact to evaluate both yourselves and me before the election, quite honestly.
I was hoping that you'd do it after election.
I bet you were. You have one last bit of homework.
One more fling.
We didn't want you to miss
one,
them.
One more time through.
And I think that was on the advice of Mike Gilbert, too, from MASC. He thought that made logical sense.
Yeah, he hates me. I'm sure that wasn't the reason. All right. Now, a subcommittee schedule, SSBC meets here tomorrow evening at 5:30. Athletic Facilities Committee on March 2nd at 7. And that's also here. Athletic Subcommittee meets March 7th at 12:30 in the afternoon in the superintendent's conference room. Finance Planning Team meets March 10th at 8:15 a.m. in the superintendent's conference room. Policy Subcommittee is March 16th, 2:30 in the superintendent's conference room. Evaluation Subcommittee is March 29th at 3 in the superintendent's conference room. And Evaluation Subcommittee meets again on April 6th at 3 in the superintendent's conference room. And you have an administrative report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a few things to highlight for you. We mentioned just a moment ago about the little school roof. So you know, again, I continue to be pleased with the effort of all involved to bring about a successful completion of the actual construction portion of the project. There was a little bit of work done over the February vacation, some minor interior and exterior work, of which we were anticipating would be completed during the February vacation week. It just made sense when the teachers were not in session. I'm pleased to tell you that the closeout process, which began in the fall and is anticipated to last some 9 months, believe it or not, has begun. We're expecting some closeout documents from the architectural firm by March the 6th. And I can tell you confidently, it's obvious that the project was completed on schedule, but we are well under budget. I don't have an exact figure for you, but I think the town stands to net approximately $90,000. Michael, would you say? Mm-hmm. I think it was roughly $169,000 savings, yep, of which the reimbursement back to MSBA at the tune of, I think it was 46.58 was our mm-hmm. reimbursement rate. So
that means the town will borrow less, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
So, and the finance director for the town is aware of those figures. But,
great.
You know, I think that project was a successful one and certainly will extend the life of the little school. I restated on my report to you the community impact teamwork because we had a change to the date of the John Morello performance. Unfortunately, that had been scheduled for February 13th, but I needed to close schools because of the snow. So we have rescheduled both the student performances for grades 11 and 12, as well as the community performance at 6:30 on that same day. That now will be held on April 3rd. So just a little FYI on that. And we have a very significant sign up for that. I'm really thrilled with some 125, I think, people to date signed up to come to the evening presentation. So he's very good. John Morrell is very good. And then just a reminder, and Dan, if you wouldn't mind, the North Reading Night Off, if we could just promote that for Tuesday, March 14th. And then I think I've told you before about a presentation. I'll be doing some more marketing on Dr. Ruth Pote, who's coming on Thursday, May 18th. We also, I'm very pleased, and I have an informational flyer on both the North Reading Night Off. If you have occasion to distribute these, I gave them to you in color so that if you had a place where you could promote these, either at your place of work or otherwise, to generate some additional interest. For the second year, we have the Northeast Massachusetts Youth Orchestra coming to North Reading. There's a flyer attached to my report to you. Two performances on May 7th. I did have the opportunity to go to one performance of the two last year. It was very good. Some really talented young people, amazingly young, talented students, really, that just do some incredible work. I was particularly impressed with the strings. I mean, just really, really a nice afternoon. It's free admission. It's the organizers, particularly Terry Murphy, that Mr. Bowers introduced me to back a year and a half or so ago. They love our venue, and I think it's really a nice opportunity. It's kind of what I think we all envisioned the Performing Arts Center could be used for community events.
Almost so. Like going to the Boston Symphony.
It really is.
Without
it really
the
is. They do it. Yeah, right. Without the free admission. So. That's coming up on May the 7th. It's a Sunday. Two performances at 2:30 and 5 p.m. Very, very well well worth the your attendance. So that's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
No correspondence.
No, sir.
We have a regular meeting on March 6th at 6:30. Fiscal year 2018 preliminary budget presentation. March 13th, town meeting, pre-meeting, superintendent's conference room. And March 13th at 7 at town meeting. March 23rd, 3:30, fiscal year 2018 budget workshop in superintendent's conference room. March 27th, regular meeting at the Hood, and April 10th at 6:30, the fiscal year 2018 budget public hearing. Anything else?
Motion to adjourn? Motion to adjourn?
I'm sorry, I just had one quick.
Come on, Jerry.
One more, hold that motion.
Real quick, I promise. I'm going to try to keep a light agenda for next Monday, particularly where we just met tonight. I'm hoping we can do that because I think that the budget, preliminary budget presentation.
It's not just budget.
I think there might be, no, I don't, right now, I don't think there is anything for just the distribution of the documents, the evaluation.
Okay.
So.
There may be a requirement for an adult beverage too after we go over the budget.
Well, that depends on much discussion. I just wanted to.
It's okay, now. It's made and seconded to adjourn?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I won't be present.